100 years ago, a woman named Julian, who lived in the town in England called Norwich, she loved the church. She gave all that she had to the church. She lived in the church, literally in the church, in a small cell attached to the church. And this woman called Julian, who lived in Norwich, who loved God and loved the church, was a woman of big ideas. She wrote a book called Revelations of Divine Love, and it is the first book ever written in English by a woman. She wrote it when she was 30 years old. The Black Death had struck the village of Norwich 3 times in Julian's short life. It had killed 1/3 of the people in England. In May of 1373, Julian felt sick. While she laid in her bed halfway between life and death, her family called the priest to anoint her one last time. As the priest stood at the foot of her bed holding a crucifix, Julian gazed at the crucifix, feeling her body nearing the end. Suddenly, she fell into a mystic state and saw heaven open up and gazed at Christ in all his glory. He showed her 16 visions. The book she wrote is her memory of these 16 revelations of divine love. In her 13th vision, Julian asked a question that had troubled her for some time. Why is there sin in the world? Why had God not stopped it? Sin has brought so much pain and suffering in this world. We inflict so much pain on ourselves and on others. Our collective sin is enormous. And Julian wanted to know the meaning of it. Her heart was broken. In the midst of this great pain and agony, Jesus did not answer her question. He simply said, "All shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well." Exactly why things are wrong is impossible to say. Why there is sin, why there is pain, why there is so much hell on earth is beyond knowing. The hope of the Christian faith does not depend on what we cannot be known. Rather, it confesses that in the end, all the brokenness will be put right. Christ is risen from the dead. All shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. For centuries, Christians have meditated on the words of Julian of Norwich. We have repeated her prayer over and over. Her revelations of divine love teach us that God suffers alongside creation and loves us as a mother loves her child. When the hells of this world flare up around us, Julian points us to the greater reality of Christ, who promises us that all shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. There is much in our world that makes us wonder whether this is really true. Our lives are full of things that eclipse the compassionate love of God, from our personal difficulties to our country's own divisive and violent political climate. We face an onslaught of despair that can leave us feeling like there is no hope. So we keep working, believing that if we stop, all will be lost. Our gospel lesson this morning paints a picture of Jesus and his disciples in the midst of demanding work. People all around them were in pain from sickness, poverty, and political oppression. The work was enormous and unyielding. The pain of hell was obvious. Jesus and the disciples traveled around the countryside ministering to people in need. Everywhere they went, more kept coming. When Jesus heard all that they had done and still had left to do, He invited the disciples to come away with him to a deserted place all by themselves so that they could rest for a while. Yes, there was more work to do, but Jesus affirmed that they had done enough for the time being. They could rest because the work they were doing was not really their own. It was God's work. God was bringing it to completion, and they were merely cooperating with the work God was doing. When the disciples felt overwhelmed by the hell around them, Jesus showed them that all shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. We do not come to this truth on our own. It is not as though we can look out at the world around us and determine that things will actually be well. We cannot believe that all will be well when we are weighed down by heavy burdens or running for our lives. We only come to know this truth by devoting time to be renewed and restored by the presence of God. God gave us the Sabbath so that we would take time for rest and spiritual reflection. When we neglect rest, we easily burn out, causing our work to suffer and putting strains on our relationships. When we are intentional about cultivating a practice of regular Sabbath rest, our hearts, minds, and souls are renewed, and we can know for ourselves the hope of the resurrection. All shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. It can be difficult to carve out time for rest in our lives. We are busy people, and many of our lives are heavily scheduled, whether by choice or necessity. On top of our personal difficulties, we as a country face an onslaught of political divisiveness and violence that robs us of hope. In moments like these, when our lives are distracted and overwhelmed by the hells of the world around us, Jesus invites us to train our minds on him. Though the demands of life seem never-ending, our value is not wrapped up in what we do, or how much we do, or which side of the political war is winning. God is at work in the world through us, and God will bring this work to completion. Wherever you are, whatever you feel, whatever you think you see just beyond the horizon, in God's time, all will be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. Amen.